but now with the wicket of Brian Lara, obliged himself to come out to the crease. He's got this one away. Chandapal now is also off the mark. Pretty simple case of pulling a short ball for four.
And done with the least possible effort as well. Five more added to take that along to 334 for five. Brian Lara, 152. Magnificent performance. Williams, 62. Campbell, 47. Richardson, 40. Arthurton, 13. And the not-out batsman, the night watchman, Dan Rash, who was originally coming in at number 11. He's unbeaten on three. And Chandapal, unbeaten on eight. Nine extras, 334 for five. The bowling figures for England. A wicket for Cork, one for Watkinson, and three for Illingworth, who bowled pretty well. Just remember that he's got a broken index finger on his right hand, not his bowling hand, and he did a good job. But for much of the time, I thought those spinners were far too short today. You can't bowl as short as that and expect to get past batsmen out. And the state of the game after 3 days, three very good days. 440 for England and West Indies, 334 for five. Lara, 152. West Indies 106 runs behind, but the star of the day...
Test cricket with Richie Benno.
There's been no shortage of heroes in this fifth Cornhill Test match. So far, though, they've all been batsmen. Michael Atherton on the first day with an innings of character and skill. Graham Hick dominated things on Friday with his undefeated century. And yesterday, eclipsing all that had gone before, Brian Lara played a classic innings. Well, who will it be today? Another batsman, perhaps? Could be Shivnarine Chandapal. Might be a bowler like Dominic Cork or Mike Watkinson. Well, welcome to the fourth day's play in this fifth Cornhill Test match at Trent Bridge. We've had three very, very good days so far and an excellent fourth one coming up, we hope. First of all, the match situation. This is the way it looks at the start of play on the fourth day with the West Indies 106 runs behind. They're 334 for five in reply to England's 440. Lara, that wonderful 152. Good innings also from Williams and Campbell. Now, the batting figures for the West Indies. Just confirming that Dan Rash, the night watchman, is there on three and going out first this morning with Chandapal, who's on eight. There are nine extras, 334 for five. And it was hard work yesterday for the England bowlers, but they did come back towards the end. Fraser, none for 58. Cork, one for 90. Watkinson and Illingworth, far too short, I thought, yesterday. One for 72 and three for 66 for them, respectively. Hick, four overs for 11. And White, five overs, no maiden and no wicket for 30. Well, the pitch will play a big part today, and here's Geoffrey Boycott with his report.
Fourth morning, and not a lot of change in this pitch, as you'd expect, the amount of runs that have been scored by both teams. This is about a good length. The seamers have not got much out of it, but this is about a reasonably good length for a spinner. There's one or two bits going here, but the spinners have got to try and overpitch, and that's hard for them after years of practicing bowling a decent length. This is a very full half-volley length. If they could make themselves pitch up here and make all the batsmen drive, you can see the poles have started to appear. But that's easier said than done, as I say. The spinners feel at this length, it's going to get hit for four, but I think that they really have to try and overpitch into the little bits of rough, because the pitch is still good and very good, basically, for batsmen.
Geoffrey Boycott with his pitch report there. And just a reminder that conditions are much cooler today. The temperature maximum will be something around about 23, 24 degrees, compared with 30 and 31 on the first 3 days. We join play now with the third ball of the second over. Richard Illingworth is the bowler, and he's bowling to Shivnarine Chandapal, the left-hander.
That's a great shot. Very confident start to the morning. Used his feet well, placed the ball well, hit it straight down the ground. A lot of bottom hand in the shot, but no problems on this occasion. Well, the bail is off. That was a wonderful piece of fielding. Good reactions from Mike Watkinson. It was Chanderpaul who was looking for the run. He was comfortably back by the look of that. Well, he's just managed to get his bat down in time. But Mike Watkinson having to turn. Nicely bowled by Mike Watkinson, drifting on quickly with the arm. Well taken by Jack Russell.
Jack Russell with the bails very quickly off here. I'm sure he must still be rueing that bad miss yesterday. Probably just getting himself organized.
Well, the appeal is there. Always worth asking the question. That ball can turn very sharply out of the rough outside the left-hander's off stump.
Well, this is certainly worth a shout. Hit outside off stump. Must have been just missing off stump.
Trouble at sea. The Trent's a dangerous place. Far safer watching Test cricket nowadays. Well bowled. An awkward delivery for Rajendra Dhanraj, which, as far as Nigel Clues is concerned, hasn't come off anything to do with bat or glove.
As with this one, once it was bowled, evasive action by Dhanraj, but I think that just hit the top of the arm guard, perhaps just clipping his shoulder. The bat was very, very low. Good decision here by the umpire.
Well, it's not as though Rajendra Dhanraj hasn't seen this sort of bowling before. You play your cricket in the Caribbean, you're inevitably going to see your fair share of short pitch bowling. So if you're looking for still life, this might be the morning. Jocelyn Galsworthy progressing nicely with her painting of Trent Bridge. A few more figures on there since I last saw it. That's in the air and brilliantly taken. Well, the tactics have worked for Dominic Thorpe. No idea why Dhanraj insisted on standing there. It proved pretty quickly to Mike Atherton, who was very close, sorry, to Nick Knight, who was very close at gully. And yet, Rajendra Dhanraj prepared to stand and wait for the decision. Thorpe had spotted a weakness, he'd played on it. And to Dominic Cork's credit, he got all those deliveries short pitched and quick enough as they were in the right spot. They were dead straight. Dhanraj was forced to fend away every one of them, and his enthusiasm waned as Dominic Cork's increased. It was a good catch. 338 for six. Courtney Brown is at the crease.
Oh, it's in the air. What a wonderful attempt at a catch.
Well, almost his eyes in the back of his head then, but it was fully driven there, and at full stretch, Atherton goes up at cover. He was walking in, that was the problem. He was walking against the tide. Two runs for that. I was quite surprised to see a fielder so deep on the leg side for Courtney Brown. An important stage of the match, this. It may seem rather becalmed, but in fact it's important for England to get a breakthrough and hopefully get the last four wickets to bowl out West Indies and take a good lead. Batsman stayed in his crease. Dominic Cork appealed, but the ball had just grazed his fingers and got onto the stumps. Then a run out was on, was possible. Well, yes, it does. And they, with great planning or with great luck, Courtney Brown was rooted to the spot.
Shout of catch it, which is good advice, I guess. There's one other requirement, though.
Yes, the batsman has to hit it.
That's good running from Courtney Brown. He's very sharp between the wickets. So is Chander Paul. .50 on the board for the West Indies. Just 90 behind now. It's not a bide with me, I can assure you. That's a neat stroke from Courtney Brown. Proving to be a bit of a stumbling block for the England bowlers. Chander Paul made 17, Courtney Brown 13.
Been that sort of morning. That's scintillating stuff. Simple half volley, wide half volley from Angus Fraser. There's a lot of wrist in this shot from Courtney Brown.
14.5 overs for 63 runs without any success in the wickets column. Not the normal thing you see with Fraser. He's normally very economical.
Not today. Not yesterday either. Angus Fraser. Colin, you were talking about his figures there, and over the period of 15 overs, they're expensive, certainly by his standards. He bowled too many short and too many full yesterday. Didn't start bowling yesterday until after lunch. But if you analyse those figures, his first six overs went for just 9 runs. So you take 6 off the first column, 9 off the third column, and you suddenly see that Angus Fraser has been taken to the cleaners by the West Indies batsmen.
Touch it!
That's up in the air, comfortably taken. Tinarine Chanderpaul has gone. Nothing complicated at all about that. So that's a reward for perseverance from Mike Watkinson.
One of the very few times you would see Shivnarine Chanderpaul in defense being beaten, because normally he uses his pads quite well. This just perhaps came onto him quicker than he expected. The last final thing to catch, relatively easy to Crawley after all of it.
Ian Bishop is the new batsman. Number 9 on the card. Two more to go after this partnership, Kenny Benjamin and Courtney Walsh.
Right.
been a very slow morning here at Trent Bridge. West Indies started on 334 for 5. They've managed to add just 32 runs in an hour and three quarters. Oh, brilliantly caught. That is as good a slip catch as you will see. Graham Hick, instinctive reflexes enough there just to clutch it with his left hand. John Edridge enjoyed that one, as I'm sure did Mike Watkinson.
But this was a good catch, ball wide-ish, and Ian Bishop not fully through pitch and driving. Watkinson some good success for some thoughtful bowling.
374 for 8. That'll be Kenny Benjamin to take strike. He's wearing a helmet, or is he? Looks like a helmet on the right there. Perhaps it's only a cap. It was a fierce blow.
Now it looks as if he's got just his cap on, and that's why there's a big problem. That's a fierce blow. I can't understand why he's not wearing a helmet, being so close. I know it's quite brave, but and in years gone by, people used to field in close without helmets, but there weren't helmets around. Now that everybody's got a helmet for batting, you should always use one with the grill when fielding close in. I'm a great believer on that. You don't really want to see a player seriously hurt.
Very, very painful for the player concerned, Nick Knight. And it just casts a pall over proceedings with all the other players as well.
Yes, Kenny Benjamin won't be feeling too clever either. He was the batsman who struck the ball. I mean, he was striking it for 4, he hoped not to hit the player.
Everyone will be keeping their fingers crossed that Nick Knight is okay. Paul Pollard is the man who's on for Nick Knight. Beautiful stroke for 4. The right idea to produce the drive, but Courtney Brown got it away a yard or so to the left hand of the fielder at extra cover. Trying to go over the top because the field was in to save the single. But that's good work from Illingworth. He flighted it nicely, kept it up to the batsman, gave him the chance to come down and defeated him. Good spin bowling.
Yes, he teased him really, just tossed it up. Real big spin ball. Nice innings ended with that stumping. He's played quite nicely. We'll be pleased with that. Disappointed to get out. He had the opportunity of getting a half century.
Courtney Walsh coming in at number 11. 384 for 9, and Courtney Brown just out for 34. Heartening news about Nick Knight. He was examined by the doctor in the ambulance. The doctor says that they will be taking him to hospital for a precautionary x-ray. That was meant to be it, but Courtney's too good for it. He's got it away for 4.
Well, I hope hope he lasts 10 or 15 minutes, Courtney Wells, because it could be really interesting cricket.
Well, that's an eight.
Well, that's a great strike, really. It has to hit this absolutely dead in the centre of the bat to clear long off and long on, and the boundary, and it really has creamed it.
400 for nine.
No second slip. That's where the edge went. Kenny Benjamin certainly not holding back.
Well, I think this just sums up Angus Fraser's bowling. He's not had a particularly good match. He's not looked like taking wickets. He hasn't taken a wicket. Pretty difficult day yesterday. A lot of runs off his bowling. He's not bowled especially well this morning. And he's not getting any luck either.
Courtney Walsh coming back for the seconds. Courtney Walsh fancying Dominic Cork, it seems. Always had two in mind. Realised that Angus Fraser, A, had just had one chase, and B, had quite a lot of distance to make to get to the ball. That's a good take as well. This must be the contest. That's nicely bowled. It's not going to get the wicket. It was a good delivery.
The initial impression here is that it was probably straight enough, but not low enough. But he was a very tall man. It hit the back pad, but it would have got over the top of the bail, I think.
Have something to show for his efforts. Courtney Walsh bowled Smith and Crop for 19.
Angus Fraser doing what his captain wants him to do, get rid of this last wicket pair. Courtney Walsh nowhere behind this. It's just about middle, cutting away to the top of the off stump. Good ball. Getting a wicket at the tail end there, but what wasted in Courtney Walsh, I think.
Well, they're never wasted completely, are they? Because England have spent a long time in the field there. They'll be happy, for the most part, to get back inside that pavilion.
That was a splendid last wicket partnership there between Benjamin and Walsh. 33 they put on from just 41 balls, and it took the total along to 417. That's much better than the West Indies might have expected at one stage. They began the day at 334 for five, at lunch 374 for eight, so they were in trouble, and every other run was a bonus. Nice performance there from Courtney Brown in only his second test match, and I thought Chanderpaul looked every inch a cricketer as well. The bowling figures for England, good performance from Illingworth, 4 for 96 in 51 overs, Watkinson 3 for 84, Cork 2 for 110, Fraser 1 for 77, but the same criticism still applies with me for the spinners, that they were too short for much of the time. But this is always a learning curve, and I've no doubt that they'll have picked up a lot from this innings. So the state of the game, England lead by 23 runs as they go into bat, and it's an enforced change in the batting order. John Crawley has had to go in with Michael Atherton because of the injury to Nick Knight. We join now with the second ball of the first over. Courtney Walsh is the bowler, and Michael Atherton is taking strike.
Very pleasant shot, pleasantly orthodox, pleasantly effective.
like Atherton is off the mark, and so is England.
They can't have fielders everywhere, and if you reduce it to one slip, I'm afraid you have to expect the flying edge to go for four.
Still don't understand this attitude of just in the third over with just one slip and one gully. England has not got a great lead. I think at this stage you should at least have one extra slip.
Well, that's an appeal for that. Confident appeal from behind. Jeff Boycott's just joined me.
Well, the interesting thing about this is the amount of bounce. Look where it goes to the keeper. Really whistled through, cut him in half. Ian Bishop, after he'd stopped appealing, he actually looked at the pitch. He couldn't believe he got the ball to bounce off the seam and cut back. Never touched it.
Oh, that was a nasty ball, and that struck Mike Atherton a painful blow. Really winced then. Now, what was that, Geoffrey? Left hand?
Well, again, they are tall, these West Indies. Just a little bit of nippy on the finger end of the right hand, I think.
Right hand.
You get that, particularly as an opening batsman, more than the lower order players, because the ball is hard, it's new. See, just there it is. It's just been a nice little nudge. It's trapped it to the bat handle.
It looks, in fact, like the top hand, the left hand. That was the one he left on the bat. That's good news. Mike Atherton ready to resume.
Has done a great deal of damage without much effort from the batsman. John Crawley has shouldered arms in much the same way as Nick Knight did in the first innings. He's Knight's replacement in the second, but this time it was a little more definite. Bowled by Walsh for 11.
Well, that's not the first time John Crawley has padded up to Courtney Walsh. If you remember, he did the same at Old Trafford. He just lets it go, you see. It's the angle Walsh bowls from, slightly wide of the crease.
And the man who made the century in the first innings comes out now. That's good breakthrough for West Indies. No easy task out there for the batsman. Atherton struck on the finger. Quite a nasty blow. Now Crawley removed without playing a stroke. For that, plus a glare, only a moderate glare from a man of Ian Bishop's equable temperament, but a glare nonetheless. That's a good shot. The chap who is getting all the applause there, fairly sturdily built, and the applause is because he keeps going and collecting 6 pints of beer and bringing them back, and although he seems to have a lot of friends around him, he drinks them all himself. Just wrong-footed Raji Danraj there as he was coming across to field that on his right hand. It was a good shot from Michael Atherton.
It trouble is on this pitch for the bowlers, you only have to be slightly offline or over-pitched or under-pitched, and it's pretty easy to take runs from the bowlers.
That's good enough. Kenny Benjamin strikes. That one scuttles through low and quickly.
Well, suddenly this game has changed into something interesting. 36 for 2 could effectively be 36 for 4. There are two injured men in Knight and Illingworth.
Well, there was just a little bit of movement back in between bat and patch. Just enough to defeat the stroke. And Graham Hick looked to be late on the shot. Graham Thorpe, the new batsman. And there's a challenge ahead of him and Mike Atherton now. Just to update you on the news of Nick Knight, all is reported to be relatively well. He's got a headache, but there is no cause for alarm, and he is expected back on the ground later today. Great delivery. Very similar to the ball that dismissed Graham Thorpe in the first innings. That's fueled by the commentary box.
That's a cracking shot. There are two men down there. It wasn't a bad ball. It was bowled deliberately because there was a man back for the catch at deep square leg. Another one fine. Hair transplants are all the rage these days. Ah, so simple that. It was very nicely played indeed. And that gets through square of cover. A bit frustrating for Kenny Benjamin.
Campbell made a big effort to stop that. In fact, to catch it. He's pretty good. Courtney Walsh is looking extremely inconvenienced there.
I think he's got a problem, and I think he'll go off. He went to field the ball at mid-off, and Richie immediately swapped him over to mid-on. This is what happened. It was just a steady little push by Michael Atherton. Walsh sort of got his feet probably a little bit stuck and awkwardly picked up the ball. There's nothing untoward there, but he obviously got his feet in the wrong position and just tweaked something.
He's got a slip and leg slip, or slip and leg gully it is, and three men on the offside. That's a perfectly orthodox field for a leg spinner for a left-hander. Two on the on, saving a single. I wouldn't believe it, but he's given the first run a full toss. Two quicker bowlers for the West Indies have done very well today. Courtney Walsh bowled with pace and movement, and Ian Bishop is doing the same thing now.
Each has managed to get some swing out there. The ball's 30 overs old. Seems still to be a little bit of shine on one side of it, which is just what the pace bowlers want. 100 lead now for England. And he looks as though he's outside off stump.
This was probably an easy decision in the end for the umpire.
Great shot from Grantorpe. The bounce and the spin generally quite predictable. And once the ball is this short, there's more than enough time to get in position and execute the shot. Oh, that's come back a little bit the other way. But still had plenty to do.
Again, word to shout.
Well, they're looking for two. Should make them comfortably enough. And it's enough to bring up the 50 partnership between Mike Lallerton and Graham Thorpe, the last wicket falling at 36. Swung away pretty well. And four runs. This has been a persistent fault of Dan Raj's. Again this afternoon, pitching too short. Graham Thorpe just able to help that round with the spin.
Yeah, this is very bad bowling.
That was a bit quicker, but the result is going to be much the same. Dan Raj desperately trying to get this ball up onto a good full length, yet to succeed. Great shot. Down the gap, perfectly placed. Good fighting stuff from Grantorpe. A wee bit optimistic there from the small scoreboard. England just on 100, not on 500.
11 more runs added to take the final score up to 111 for 2, 8 extras in that total. It was a good partnership between Michael Atherton and Graham Thorpe. Things weren't looking dangerous, but you wouldn't want to lose another wicket or so there with Nick Knight injured and also Richard Illingworth with a broken index finger on his right hand. As it was, Atherton 38 and Thorpe 47 saw them through to the close and were batting with great confidence towards the end. Now, the bowling figures for West Indies, they did very well once again. Walsh, I thought, bowled superbly in that first spell. 12 overs, 2 maidens, and 1 for 27. Bishop also bowled outswingers and leg cutters for much of those 13 overs, 4 maidens, and he had 27 taken from him and had no luck at all. Benjamin, 1 for 26. Dan Raj, 4 overs for 22. And Atherton, in the end, brought on to keep things tight. 4 overs, no maiden, no wicket for 7. So the state of the game, one day to go, and England 134 runs ahead. So they were in trouble at one point. Now there's just a little glimmer for them. They can at least put pressure on the West Indians later on in the day. 134 runs the lead, and Geoffrey Boycott now for his ideas on the way things might go tomorrow.
Well, a disappointing day because nothing really happened. Neither side could take control of the game or gain the upper hand. Why was that? Well, I think that both sides are a little shy of winning. Two all, neither of them wants to lose with only two test matches to go. And the batsmen, probably one of the few times in the series, they've seen a very flat batting pitch. They're being extra safe and extra careful in what they do. That's not been very good for the spectators. On a pitch as good as this, flat, dry, no bounce or pace, 194 runs were scored, and I think that was poor reward. I'd like to tell you that there will be a result tomorrow, but I can't. It's definitely going to be a draw.
Geoffrey Boycott with his ideas on the way the game has gone after 4 days of this Cornhill Test match at Trent Bridge. We'll be on air tomorrow. It'll be BBC One at 10:55 a.m. We look forward to having you with us then. For the moment, from Trent Bridge, it's good night.